You know, when I inevitably get fired, AJ, from SiriusXM for sexual harassment, drunk on the job, God only knows what, I wish I could leave my workplace the way Oluwole Bombose does. Yesterday, he tweeted this out. So it's official. I'm no longer a part of the UFC organization. Not gonna lie, I fell out of love with it for obvious reasons. One being a target of unfair treatment multiple times. And second, the organization not taking care of its fighters financially. At Dana White, fuck you, MMA comeback, Armstrong emoji. I had to know what this was all about. So we hit the guy up himself. Oluwole Bombose joins us now on MMA Tonight. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, how's it going? How's it going, man? Thanks for having me, man.
Fantastic. Happy holidays. Thanks for coming on. First question, what happened between you and the UFC?
Man, all I have to say is that, you know, I was always a team player in terms of whoever they gave me, I fought, man. No ifs, ands, or buts, you know. And I was put in a position where, you know, financially I was struggling, even with being in the UFC. And, it didn't really dawn on me that this was something that was going to really affect me. But then after a while, it really started to, like hit me, you know. Like, man, you know, I always thought, for me, making it to the UFC was the pinnacle or one of the pinnacles or one of the success routes sports-wise. You know, like making it to the NFL or NBA. But listen, man, like those leagues are untouchable in terms of how they treat their athletes, you know, or unprecedented, or how could I say they're on another level in terms of how they care for their athletes. And the UFC has a lot of learning to do, a lot of growing to do in that sense too. And for me, it's like we're under like a dictatorship. Fuck it, I'm gonna say it, man. Dana White is a fucking dictator, bro. The motherfucker's like Hitler, bro. He's like the Hitler of MMA. You know what I mean? Like, he's just doing whatever the fuck he wants and not taking into consideration of fighters and their families, their situation, things of that nature. And man, listen, man, I haven't been one to complain. You know, recently I've been hearing from a lot of, you know, crackhead bullshit fans that, you know, you were a crybaby, all this other bullshit. But you know what? If you had to face what I had to go through, You wouldn't be happy either. First of all, why did the UFC Photoshop my face? That's what I want to know. That's what I've been trying to figure out, you know, since my June fight. You know, during my June fight with Paulo Costa, you know, which is that pretty boy Brazilian Superman-looking motherfucker, you know, whatever. He's handsome, that's great. You know, it's a fight. Who gives a fuck about who looks better? But there was a flyer that was put out, and it was a picture of me and him. And I'm looking at my face, and I'm like, whoa, like, what the fuck is that? And basically, what some UFC media rep did, I don't know whose orders it was under, but what they did was they de-arched my lip. I made, like, somewhat of a snarl-type expression, you know what I mean? Like, you know,
they photoshopped it.
They photoshopped my fucking lip. Arched it. So for me, it's like I can't even be myself as a fighter. I can't even express myself as basically what that expression reflected. Bring it on, motherfuckers. So they fucking de-arched my lip. I look like a freaking Scooby Doo, bro. You know what I mean? And I look like I had this expression of bring it, you know what I mean? And who gives a fuck if I look intimidating? Like, it's the fight business, you know what I mean? Like, I want guys to be afraid of me. Fuck that, that's an advantage. Why are you trying to take that away from me? You know, and then not only that, that motherfucker missed me on stage, and look, I'm not one to be unprofessional, but, dude, it's a waiting, bro. You know what I mean? Like, it's not the fight. We're going to fight, bro. Like, what are you doing? So he mushes me, and they didn't find him. And then on top of that, when we go backstage, and I'm about to, you know, get ready, and I'm pissed off, but, you know, I'm ready to get back on the bus, this motherfucker starts antagonizing me again. Then I hear from a UFC rep that passes by, if you touch him, the fight's off. And for me, it's like, I want to fight this motherfucker, because number one, I need to get fucking paid. And number two, I want to fuck this motherfucker up. He just mushed me. So I had to restrain myself from fighting him, even though he missed me, and backstage, he started to continue to antagonize me, man, which is weird, because I'm like, bro, do you even want to fight me? Because the way he was attacking me was like, he didn't want to fight. Maybe he was looking for a way out, but whatever. I was the bigger person even backstage as well. And I walked away, got on the bus. But you know what? That nice guy mentality is what fucked me over during the fight, because he ended up having an edge. That edge was, you know, he had somewhat of a psychological edge, you know? He pushed me, you know what I mean? Like, and I didn't do anything back.
so you feel like the UFC, sorry to cut you off, you feel like the UFC was protecting him specifically from you, from
100%. If you even see the lanes, you see that he mushed me and they grabbed me first, which almost seemed like it was scripted. So I'm like, what the fuck is this, WWE? And when it happened initially, I didn't think nothing of it. But when I saw the fucking replay of the wings, I'm like, yo, why are people grabbing my arms first? And the motherfucker is still loose. And Paulo's a big dude. Bro, he could have snuffed me, bro, as one of the security guys are grabbing me. So, you know, why am I going through shit like this, man? My face is being photoshopped so I could look, you know, less intimidating and shit, or maybe uglier, who knows? You know, you got guys mushing me and not getting fined, but I bet you if I mushed him, Bronx UFC fighter gets kicked out of UFC for acting unprofessional.
Let me ask you real quick, and Olawale Bamboise has joined us right now. Loving the passion, loving the honesty, but from where I'm sitting, just those two things you brought up, photoshopping your mouth and kind of protecting you from one of their fighters backstage, that doesn't sound terribly horrible to me. That doesn't sound like they're really holding you back to me. Is there more to it than just this instance?
I mean, for me, you know, all these things for me is like, it's leading up to, number one, an unprofessional setting that I thought that I could be a part of. But you know what? It's the fight business. So, you know what? What did I expect? Number two, I feel like, my face being photoshopped was, man, that was a violation of my rights, man. I don't give a fuck what anybody says, man. Mm-hmm. You know, McGregor, I don't see his face being photoshopped. I don't see Mayweather's face, even though this guy's on a grand scale, and I'm not saying that, I'm not comparing my career to theirs. But what I am saying, they are professionals, and professional athletes like to be genuine in the sense of, you know, them being themselves. And if that's tampered with, any pro athlete would feel some kind of way. You know, and this is not about, you know, me personally feeling, you know, how can I say, like, insecure or whatever. This has nothing to do with insecure. It has to do with, like, yo, don't fuck with my face. Or at least ask me. Have the decency to ask me. You know what I mean? And then it's like, I don't know, man. And then the pay is not good at all, too, man. You know, I feel like, you know, freaking ring girls, octagon girls get paid more than the fighters, man. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that's ridiculous, man. The fans don't go to the UFC events to see the ring girls, man. For all that, they can go to a fucking strip club. Why are they making more money than us? You know what I mean? We're the ones going in there, risking our lives, going in there fucking pretty much butt-ass naked, you know what I mean, with no protection other than a mouthpiece, you know, groin protector, and fucking MMA, you know, fucking really hard, you know, legged MMA glove, you know what I mean, that are like about 4 ounces, bro, that feel like concrete, bro. You know what I mean? Like, it is what it is. It's the fucking, man, I'm not gonna lie, I just got tired of taking pain for the fucking bullshit organization that I'm a part of. And also, some of these fans, man, they're nasty, bro. Like, they're really nasty. And it dawned on me, like, is this really what I want to do? And as I'm in my last fight, I had this session with myself, like this one-on-one session with myself. Like, is this your life, bro? Like, is this what martial arts means to you?
Let me ask you. Let me ask you then. I mean, if you know you're done with the UFC, are you done with MMA, or do you think you'll get better treatment at ONE FC or Bellator or somewhere else?
Right now, I don't know what I'm going to do, but I know I'm definitely going to take some time off, a few months, maybe in a few years, man, just to get myself back on track. Now, let me tell you a little bit about my situation. Like, with the UFC, I got signed in 2015. So, in 2015, what I did was I put myself in a position where I made a lot of sacrifices, man. I had to let a lot of things go because financially I couldn't handle it. I don't want to get too in depth with or too detailed with what those things are, but just know I made a lot of sacrifices, man, just so that I could elevate my game. I can get better. And I thought that, you know, within a few months, hopefully a year, that I'll be able to see the fruit of my labor or the fruit of my sacrifice. But no, I'm like, man, this is going on two and a half years, man, where I'm freaking really suffering, man. Like, you know, when am I going to get a fucking break? You know what I mean? And then not for nothing, you know, I was given a fair chance to fight some of these guys. And I mean, I get it. Some of which I wasn't, you know, my first fight was against Uriah Hall. That was about, a week and a half I had to prepare for a veteran like that. But it is what it is, man. I fought him and I lost that. It is what it is. Second fight came, I had about a month to prepare for him, Daniel Serafin, and I was able to knock him out spectacularly, by the way. And that's another bias that I want to talk about. So with that fight, listen, man, I don't mean to brag, but that was a pretty awesome KO. Why? Because I kicked through his block. Like, who does that? You know what I mean? And sure. I thought, you know, that was enough for me to get a bonus. And see, that's the thing with the UFC bonuses, man. They're biased as fucking hell, man. You could have an awesome KO or an awesome submission, but I don't know who the fuck is distributing the bonuses. But if they like a guy who at least gets some type of finish, doesn't matter how spectacular it is, if they like that guy, he's going to get the bonus over you. And for me, it's like, I'm not even hating on the guy that got that bonus, you know, before me or whatever the case is. I believe that since the UFC pays the fighters so shitty, like, the least fucking Dana White and the UFC could do is any fighter who gets a finish should get a fucking bonus. You know, that's an incentive right there that would you know, cause a lot of, you know, finishes. You know, a lot of guys will look for the KO, look for the sub, knowing that no matter what, they're going to get paid because they got a finish. As opposed to them getting a finish and then them hoping, like, man, I hope my KO is enough. It's not easy knocking somebody out, man, especially on this level. It's not easy.
Well, you'd be a bajillionaire because all your wins are first round knockouts. So yeah, obviously you love that idea. But look, right now, like, you're making tons of sense to me, and you're echoing a lot of complaints that a lot of other UFC fighters have had. This isn't obviously the first time fans have heard this, but playing devil's advocate, there's someone driving in their car right now listening to this interview, and they're saying, look, Oluwole, he lost 4 or 5 fights in the UFC, he lost 3 fights in a row, he got cut, and he's just mad because he got fired. What would be your answer to them?
My answer would be, you know, due to circumstances that related to getting a job, a third job at that, because I own my own gym, but I also had to get a job as a fucking cable guy, man. And that's where I hurt myself. I almost fell through a roof, man. Almost hit concrete. My head on concrete. I almost died, man. But you know what? I ended up hurting my whole left side, so I bruised my pelvis and I hurt my hip. I also hurt my sprain in my knee too, on my left side. So I had about two to three weeks prior to the fight. So, you know, I'm not one to call out. And not for nothing, if I called out, who knows, I probably would have got cut, because that's the fucking cutthroat organization or, you know, job that I work for. It sucks, man. You can get injured, legitimately injured, but if you call out, the UFC is like, you know what, we're cutting him, you know what I mean? And it's over, you know what I mean? But anyways, I got hurt, but I stuck it through. I said, you know what, it's not fair to my opponent, and I said I was going to fight, so I'm going to fight, but it's a fight that I should have probably postponed, but I didn't. But it is what it is. I wasn't able to train, number one, like I should have, because I was so busy worried about surviving and making it. Secondly, I got hurt, man. So the odds were just against me, man. And it is what it is. I didn't get to. I just want fans to know that, number one, that was not the best me at all. Secondly, I was injured, so I couldn't really be as flashy as I usually am. That's why I tried to play the safe route, the cautious route, you know, and be a lot more patient. Plus, if you notice, I didn't kick, I didn't throw any high kicks because I really was fucking hurt. But how many fighters would actually do that? How many fighters are brave enough to still take on a fight hurt? You know what I mean? Yeah, it was stupid on my part, but hey, I had to make a living, so I had to do what I had to do. But it is an excuse, but honest to God, on my life, that is the truth. That's the honest to God truth, and it is what it is, man. But like I said, I'm not going to end my career off in that note. I'm going to take some time off. I'm going to regroup. I'm going to train my ass off, and I'm going to come back to combat sports. Who knows what it'll be in? Who knows what sector? But like I said, I have to earn my right to come back. I'm going to get my life situated as far as outside of the cage goes, make sure those situations are handled, because I thought that, you know, I would make enough so that I won't have to deal with that. But apparently, you know, no, you know, making it to the UFC is not enough. You know what I mean? Fucking bench warmers and these major leagues that I mentioned make more than us, which is pretty sad. You know what I mean? Ring girls or octagon girls make more than us, which is fucking sad. So you know what I mean? But anyways, I digress. I'm going to come back just to have better closure, and so that fans really know what my skill is all about. And that'll be that. I'll probably fight 1 to 3 more times, possibly. Who knows? But at least definitely once. And then that'll be that, man. I'm going to hang up the gloves. But, hey, so, you know, I just...
Sorry to cut you off there, but when you found out you were released, how did they do it? Who called? Did they go to you? Did you get an email? Like, what happened?
Yeah, I got an email from one of the UFC reps. And, it was just some termination email. And that was that. But, you know, it is what it is, man. You know, life goes on. That's why I'm glad I at least have a backup plan, in the sense that I went to school, I have a master's degree. So at any point in time, I could just, you know, just say, hey, you know what? I'll get a regular job, salary-based job, and just you know, an office job, which I dread, but hey, I got to pay the bills and make the money. But hey, I'm still going to somehow squeeze training in there. And or maybe I don't have to get a regular job. Maybe I'll just, you know, continue to hustle. But there's certain things that I have to make sure, once again, are in order before I come back, because it was fucking my psyche. You know, it was fucking my psychological. And I can't fight under that pressure, under those circumstances. I want to fight happy. When I was in the UFC, a lot of the times I fought under pressure. I fought depressed, you know, and it's a hostile crowd, man. So if you're already, you know, going in there, you know, a little distressed, and you're in front of that hostile, drunk crowd, it's not easy, man. And then you got your opponent, obviously, who's trying to kill you. But hey, it's the profession I chose. I love martial arts. I do, and I'll always have love for it. And I believe I still have a lot to give to the sport. And God willing, I'll be able to be a part of an organization that will build me, will help build me, not give me easy fights, but will build me the right way.
We will be there watching. We love to keep this going on. We're up against it, but dude, you've been absolutely awesome. You completely brought it today. We love your honesty. We love the insight you get us. And honestly, win or lose, you've always put on exciting fights. First round knockouts all over the place. Wherever you land, we will follow you. And thanks for coming on, Oluwale. We appreciate it.
I appreciate it, man. And remember, with God, anything is possible. Just make sure you're faithful to Him, and you'll be able to conquer all and anything.